Hi, helper. Are you going to help us sew today?
The first thing I'm going to do is start with a full bobbin and full spool thread. Seems obvious. These little weird things up here, that changes the position of your needle. I don't know if you can see that moving. And the next one is the length of your stitch. I like to do a 2.8 when I'm sewing, just because if you do a smaller length than if you need a seam rip, it's annoying to get those stitches out. You want to make sure and start with a fresh needle as well. I use number 12 Microtex needles. That's not necessary, but I just think that they are the best through woven cotton fabric, but whatever you have in the house will be fine. To change out your needle, you'll need the chuck that came with your sewing machine, and you'll take it, and there's a little screw up here. You'll undo that, and you'll pull this out, and you'll notice that there is a flat side and a rounded side. The flat side of the needle is gonna go towards the back when you put it in. After you have your machine threaded and your bobbin in, you want to take your hand and use the hand crank, the little wheel on the side, and bring your needle down. That way you can pull up the bobbin thread and then pull it back. That way when you first start stitching, you don't get a weird nest of stitches on the back of your fabric. And then after I have that pulled through, I just like to nip it so it's just a couple inches long. So once you have your fabric cut out, you have your three mirrored image sets. This one's the pocket, the outer, and the lining. The lining's not going to be seen, and you want to make sure that your outer and your pocket are different colored fabrics so that you can easily tell them apart when you're putting it on your face. If it's just for home use, it's not a big deal, but if you're going to make them to donate, you wanna make sure that they're different colors so that the hospital professionals can quickly tell the sides apart. So we're gonna start by sewing the curved edge on each one of our mirrored image sets. Okay, so now when you start with your quarter inch seam allowance, what I do is I like to move my needle so that the quarter inch is exactly at the edge of my foot. It doesn't have to be, you know, a precise quarter inch. Whatever you choose to be your seam allowance, you just want to make sure and you stay consistent with that so that your pieces match up consistently when you go to sew them together. So my needle is perfectly centered. Okay, so we put our fabric right sides together under the foot. I like to start about a quarter inch in, and I put my needle down and I do one stitch forward and then I do a few stitches backwards. The reason for that is if you start at the very edge of your fabric, it's gonna get caught in the feed dogs of your sewing machine and it's gonna be really annoying. So start a little bit on the inner edge and then sew all the way to the end, making sure you can pin this if you want, especially if you're new to sewing, so your fabric doesn't what's it called? So your fabric stays all together. I don't know what I'm talking about. So now you have your seam is all sewn, and we're gonna do that for each of our pieces before we do anything else. You get to the end, back stitch a few times. My machine has a little cutter on the end. You can have nips ready. So you have one more set to do. And after you do each of these, you after you sew each seam allowance, you're gonna take them and you're gonna trim the edges. I have a special serrated cutter so that it makes the curve lay a little bit nicer. I know that most people probably won't have that at home, so you can take scissors and clip notches, or you don't even have to do that really. It's just, it helps the curve lay a little bit more flat if you cut them like that.
I have my edges serrated or clipped. I'm gonna push the seam to one side so that I can top stitch along the other side, and that seam will lie flat. At this stage, you could iron it and press your seam, but I just do it with my finger while I'm at the sewing machine. I like to just set the seam after it's been top stitched, so rather than iron multiple times, I'm just doing it once. But if you want to be anal about it, you could do both.
When you start top stitching, you want to make sure you have a longer stitch length.
Excuse you.
I like to do a 3.5, you could do a 4. It really depends on your machine and what that top stitching looks like. With this machine, I'm gonna move my needle over to the very edge so that I can get that real tight 1/8 inch top stitch along the seam to make sure my my cut seam lies flat after I top stitch. So you need to make sure that you're pushing that over to the side, the serrated edge that you just cut, so that it's getting caught in the top stitching. Do a back stitch at the beginning, at the end. Cut your stitches. Honestly, these stitches look like shit. I haven't been using this machine and my tension is off. I think it's because I'm using a different thread weight in the bottom than in the top. And I haven't been using this machine. I just started using this for this video since it's my home machine. So I would need to actually troubleshoot my tension. My bobbin thread is showing. So I think that my top thread stitching is too tight, the tension's too tight in it, but I'm not gonna mess with that right now. I'm just, whatever, that looks like shit. Yours will look better than that. The back side will look like that because you've got the serrated edges caught, and you see now you have some shape to your mirrored image pieces. This is the lining piece for mine. I'm sorry, no, that was actually the pocket piece. This would be the front. Okay, I cheated and moved sewing machines, the one I've been using to make the mask. I was gonna use my home machine because I thought more people would have a machine like that than this, but I don't feel like messing with the tension. So there is the shitty stitching from bad tension. And then here is the good tension. So, you know, if your sewing looks bad, maybe it's your tension, or maybe you just had too much wine. I don't know. So you have your, I forget what I'm doing. You have your exterior fabric and your lining fabric and your pocket fabric. So with your pocket fabric, you know that it's going to go against your lining. So the wrong side of your pocket will be against the right side of your lining. So what we want to do to create the pocket, we're going to have to hem one of the edges. You could hem, if you want an open pocket and both sides to be open, you would hem both edges. But if you just want one side to be open, you're gonna hem one edge. So what you need to do is press 1/4 inch under. Don't measure it, just kind of eyeball it, just
press underneath what you think will be enough for the iron to fold over and not be annoying. And then you're gonna fold it over again after you pressed it so that there are no raw edges. And then you're gonna take that pressed edge and you're gonna leave it the wrong side up so that you make sure and catch the edge. Because if you did it from the front side, you know, you might not catch all of the edge, and you want to make sure that that all gets caught in your seam. If it looks bad from the underside and you want to stitch from the front, you can. I just prefer to stitch from the back so I know that I'm catching that bit in the seam. So my stitching looks the same from the front and the back. If your tension is right on your machine, that's how it should look. And honestly, it's the inner pocket of your mask. No one is gonna see it. So, and then what you wanna do, you take your pocket and your lining. I should have used different fabrics for this so you could differentiate between the two. The lining is the longer piece and the pocket is your shorter piece. And you're gonna line up that center seam. And what you can do is baste the edges together so that it stays in place. Honestly, when I'm making masks, I don't baste this because it's just an extra step. But if it's your first time making masks, I would, or first time sewing really, I would baste it because it's difficult to do all three layers without them shifting. And basting just means you make your stitch length as long as possible and you don't backstitch. I'm gonna do about an eighth of an inch basting stitch here, making sure my seams line up. And you can pin your fabric if you want. I'm not gonna bother with that. So that top edge is basted. I'm gonna baste the bottom edge now, an eighth of an inch away. And that the basting stitch will not be seen because you're gonna do a quarter inch seam when you sew the masks together. So now your pocket is basted to your lining. And when you sew the lining and the outer together, your pocket's already basted. You're just going to put right sides together, right of your lining and your outer, and you're gonna sew along the long edges. You're gonna leave the side edges completely open. And you wanna make sure and change back to your 2.8 stitch length or whatever stitch length you were sewing at so that your stitching is secure. Make sure you're doing a quarter inch back stitch. Make sure that's secure. Make sure your seams are lined up. You can pin, you can clip. I just don't like to do that because it takes extra time and I always get myself with pins. I don't like pins.
We don't like pins. We don't like them.
So you're gonna do both sides, quarter inch, put your needle down, back stitch, make sure your seam is lining up so that looks nice and pretty. Gets a little thick right here. On your home sewing machine, if that seam is too thick, make sure you put something behind your foot to take a little pressure off that so your seam doesn't get wonky. You might get a few extra stitches right there. It's fine. No one's gonna see. So you finished both long edges. Now what you wanna do, you can clip these curves right here to help them lay flat. I don't do that, but what I do that's important is press the seam away from each other so that when you flip this, you have a nice crisp edge to top stitch. And you're gonna do the same for both the bottom and top edge. Okay, now your edges are nice and pressed. So you're gonna start sewing top stitching. So whatever top stitch length that you chose, 3.5, 4, and you're gonna top stitch 1/8 of an inch away from the edge. Make sure you back stitch at the start and stop. The part of top stitching that you want to make sure and slow down with, especially if you don't have your fabric all the way turned under, is this top edge here, because it's pretty thick, and if you don't slow down, you're gonna get wonky top stitching. So you're gonna go all the way to the end, do your back stitch. So there is our top stitched edge. We're gonna do the same thing on the bottom, 1/8 of an inch away, back stitch. Oops, slow down a little bit, make sure your fabric's not wonky. Again, if you would have clipped your curves at the top and bottom, it would be less likely for your fabric to be laying wonky right there. I did not take the time to do that, so I needed to slow down a little bit to make sure that it wasn't wonky. Okay, so now we have our top and bottom edges stitched, and we're almost done with the mask portion. But you see we have raw edges, and this is the edge of the pocket that's also raw. We're gonna enclose that though, so don't worry about that. We're going to press this under like we did with whatever else we were pushing under 1/4 inch. And we're gonna push that, and then we're going to force it over. I would say, let's see, how far is that? 5/8 of an inch. So you went under 1/4, and now you do 5/8 away. You have room. It's gonna make a little tube to thread your string through. So we want to make sure we have enough room in our little tube to thread a string through. So turn it under and then over again about 5/8 of an inch to enclose the raw edge and to make a little tube. So we're going to press that with our iron.
Did you lose your toy? Did you lose your toy?
And once that is pressed, we're going to sew 1/8 of an inch away, only on one edge.
You got a lot to say? You have a lot to say?
Put your needle down, go down. Oh my goodness. That's a lot. Do you need more Cheesy Poofs? So now, that looks super wonky. Anyway, yours will look nicer than that because you're gonna measure and it's gonna be nice and straight. But as long as you have a tube and your edge is turned under and it's top stitched down and you back stitch really well, make sure and back stitch really well at those points because they're pressure points.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness.
Okay, so we made our side over here with the tube, and now our other side is the side with the hem pocket. So this side will be a little bit easier because you don't need to measure. You just need to turn that under and then flip it under again and press so that the pocket edge and the edge of your tube holder thingy are flush, flush, flush so that the edges meet. So we're gonna do top stitching again, eighth of an inch away from our edge that's close flush to our pocket. Make sure and back stitch really well at the beginning, at the end, because those will be pressure points where the fabric ties go in and out of the mask. So after you sew that seam and trim all those annoying little threads, you've actually already made your mask. That's all you had to do. Except now we need to make the fabric ties, unless you have twill tape. Twill tape would be so much easier because the fabric ties take a lot of time. But we'll do that in a second. We go to make fabric ties. I cut them by 1.5 inches times the width of the fabric. You might see WOF as an acronym on some sewing blogs. It just means from selvage edge to selvage edge, which is this weird edge that has like a, anyway, it's the weird edge, not the cut edge. This width is about 44 inches, and I just go ahead and cut 1.5 times times that width, and then hack off a few inches because you don't need 44 inches. You only really need about 36 inches. I make my ties about 39 inches, I would say, just to have some extra on the ends. So you're gonna need two of those. So 1.5 inches times the width of your fabric, or 1.5 inches around 36 inches. So have these two already cut. And then you're gonna take them to your ironing board. I have a bias tape maker, which not everyone will have on hand, but it makes making these fabric ties much easier. Okay, so once you have your fabric tie cut, you're going to turn each end in by 1/4 inch. That way you have no raw edges on your fabric ties, and you're gonna press that. Make sure you push both ends under. And then if you do have a bias tape maker, you're gonna slide your fabric in the bottom, and then I use a seam ripper. Some people have a special tool called an awl that they push that through. And what the bias tape maker does is, just so you don't have to measure the half width of your fabric, you're supposed to pin down, I don't know if you can see that, pin down the edge and run it along there. So that puts both raw edges on the inside. You can also have a bias tape maker. You can stick a pin in your ironing board and pull the fabric through that way. You want the width of where your pin is, the amount of space in between those two sections, to be about 1 inch wide, or whatever that half of that is. It's a little bit more than an inch, but as you can see, what you want to do is just make sure it's pulling the fabric so that it is in half and both raw edges are contained, because then hello sir, hi. Do you need more snacks? You're gonna turn that under again. So now you have your edges contained, and you're gonna stitch along that edge. And this is gonna be your fabric tie. You're gonna do this for both ties. Okay, we're almost done. We have our bias tape strip, or our fabric ties that we made. We're going to put those under our needle, make sure we're on top stitch length, and we're gonna back stitch really well, and we're gonna sew about whatever kind of length you want from the edge so that you catch both sides of the fabric in there. You'll probably want to go a little bit slower than I just did. So we got both sides in there and we made a tie. Your tie is all made.
Okay, now that you have your mask and your fabric tie, you want to take a safety pin and get it right in the edge of the tie. And then take that tube that you made, push the safety pin through, and you're gonna force it through and pull on the end so that it pulls this through. The edge of the tie will probably get caught, but just keep kind of forcing it. And then pull the tie through. I like to put about 3 extra inches of your tie at the top than at the bottom. So once you have a longer tie at the top than at the bottom, you're gonna fold this edge in half and kind of finger push it so that you get a little indentation, because you're gonna make a tack stitch right there. And what I mean by a tack stitch is just a little triple stitch right there so that your tie stays in place. So after you thread that, damn it, and you finger push to find the center, start in the center, back stitch a couple, go forward, back stitch. I just like to make sure it's real secure right there. I did kind of a crappy job. It's not completely straight. And you're gonna do the exact same thing with the other side. Get your safety pin, put it through the tie, thread it through, make sure that end doesn't get caught, push it up, pull that down, keep kind of pushing it through till the safety pin comes through, pull, and then match so that the ties are the same length, finger push, get an indentation, and do a tack stitch. And your mask is completely done. So you have your pocket to put your filtration material, tie it on your face, tie it behind, and you're good to go.